game back. Broncos, Falcons, pregame. Julio Jones. Come on. Gloves or not, that's a nice catch, Broussard.
It's a great catch, but that wouldn't even have been inbounds in college.
But let's just.
He got 0 feet inbounds.
And it wasn't clean. It was nice. It was all right. But the gloves are so gooey and sticky now.
Well, you sound like
you can't drop anything.
Your bar is way too high. To the actual game now, Denver's Brett Rippon connecting with Juwan Winfrey for a spectacular game-winning touchdown.
You got to be kidding me. I mean, I know I'm not supposed to gamble on the Hall of Fame game, but how could you not? First chance
of NFL. You
lost money on the Hall of Fame.
Atlanta plus 2.5 was too good to pass up, and then you lose on this. Man. Lose on that. You knock it down, kid.
He's trying to make the big play.
All right, Chargers, Rams, joint practice. Watch how Keenan Allen lays out to secure that catch.
I like that one. I'll take that over.
Good camera work, too.
You said this is a joint practice?
Yeah.
Surprised they didn't lose money on that. Chargers minus 6.5, the joint practice. Keenan Allen, short of the goal line.
All right, let's get back to basketball. LeBron James, former general manager David Griffin, took aim at the King in an interview with Sports Illustrated, said, among other things, that LeBron isn't the same animal about winning as he used to be. Also added that building a team around LeBron was not a great time, saying, everything we did was so inorganic and unsustainable and, frankly, not fun. I was miserable. The reason is LeBron is getting all the credit and none of the blame, and that's not fun for people. They don't like being part of that world. Nick, what was your reaction to reading that?
We can deal with the miserable part in a moment, because he's said before about the anxiety and about the pressure, and I imagine that is incredibly hard. But the last part I find so fascinating, where he said something that is repeated so often, it's just taken as a given. LeBron gets all the credit when his team wins and none of the blame when his team loses. And it's like, if you say something, if enough people say something enough times, it just becomes fact. Like, the only thing I can almost analogize it to is like what the term fake news means. Like, fake news once upon a time meant intentional disinformation published to make it look like a real news article. And then enough people just called anything they didn't like fake news that now it just means the second thing instead of the first thing. The idea that LeBron is an athlete that doesn't get criticized enough, that gets a pass for things, is so 180 degrees from the reality in which we live in. LeBron's the only athlete in the world who we could do a week-long referendum on what type of sports parent is he, right, as we just did this week. LeBron's the only athlete in the world that would say, hey, here's $6 to $10 million of my own money to supplement a public school in Cleveland. And then there would be people waving their hands on television and be like, guess what, America? I just found out how public schools work. Turns out it's your tax dollars funding it as well. LeBron is still criticized regularly on television for the 2011 finals. It is still said that he quit on the Cavs for the 2010 series against the Celtics. And if people say, well, yeah, but I mean, did he get criticized when they lost to the Warriors? No. In a finals, when you go 36-13-9 and your second best player is Matthew Dellavedova, you're not going to get criticized. And in the next finals they lose, when you average a triple-double up against what a lot of people thought is the most talented team ever, probably not going to get criticized. So does LeBron get the lion's share of the credit for the championships he's won? Well, yeah, the same way every guy who's the best player on a championship team gets the lion's share of the credit. But the idea that LeBron gets none of the blame, LeBron got blamed for getting hurt last year. LeBron got blamed for the mental impact on Brandon Ingram and Lonzo Ball because Anthony Davis demanded a trade in New Orleans. Like, this idea that LeBron skirts blame while only reveling in the glory, people who say these things, I just wonder, do you have televisions? Do you have radios? Do you read the internet? Do you see how he is covered unlike any athlete I've ever come across? So that's the part of this that just strikes me as, I know everyone says it, but it's just flatly not true.
No, you're exactly right. Look, I've said it before, I'll say it again. He is the most scrutinized athlete in the history of American sports, period. And some of it's shows like this.
Yes.
Now, every day, when Michael Jordan played, there wasn't even national 24-hour-a-day sports radio for the most part, okay? There certainly weren't debate shows or morning shows like this talking sports. So if LeBron misses a game-winning jump shot in Utah on a Tuesday night, We're scrutinizing it. We don't remember Michael Jordan's misses. We only remember the makes and the great plays and all that. So you're right. He does get plenty of criticism. As far as getting the credit, this happens when you have these types of players. Michael Jordan, what did we always say about Jordan? Jordan and the Jordanaires. That's what it was, okay? Scottie Pippen was a Jordanaire. That's what it was. When you have a player that great, that is what it is. And there's a benefit to all the players that, as David Griffin said, get all the blame. There's still a great benefit, okay? Because Kevin Love may end up being a Hall of Famer because of those two championships and all those finals appearances he had with the Cleveland Cavaliers. Chris Bosh will almost certainly be a Hall of Famer. Had he stayed in Toronto and gone out in the playoffs in the first round every year, averaged 20-10, he probably isn't a Hall of Famer. Kyle Korver is a household name because he was on those Cleveland teams that played in the finals. Kyrie Irving got the opportunity to hit arguably the greatest shot in NBA history because he was playing with LeBron James. So, yeah, I get it. LeBron is high maintenance. What Griff is saying. The one-year deals that put pressure on you to keep building around me. You know, the cryptic tweets and all of that
stuff. Passive-aggressive and high maintenance.
Yes, I mean, I get that. But the payoff is what sports is about. It's about winning. And you can go through a lot of the greatest players in history in any sport. A lot of them have been high maintenance. A lot of them have caused headaches in certain ways, but you do it because you get the end result.
When you talk about the concept of the Jordan and the Jordanaires and you liken it to what LeBron, his aura, how do you think it falls on an equal superstar, or maybe a little bit less, but who could take over, in Anthony Davis? It's not going to be, you know, like what he had in Cleveland. It may not even be what he had in Miami, but a guy like Anthony Davis, that may not sit well with him.
Well, Anthony Davis, he requested a trade to the Lakers, knowing LeBron's there, knowing the almost media ecosystem that surrounds LeBron and that surrounds the Lakers, and now that they're together, it's even greater. I think, though, LeBron has signaled, and I know he ended up not being able to give up his number, but tried to give up his number, and has signaled things like that, that he understands in year 17, when LeBron, I believe, truly does want to play far beyond this contract because he wants to have a chance to play with his son. And this idea, first of all, it might be you might be an underdog for his son to even make the NBA, much less be a guy that can come straight out of high school. We're talking about LeBron playing 5 more years, 6 more years. He knows he needs Anthony Davis, and he knows at some point he's going to have to hand the keys to the car over to Anthony Davis. And so if LeBron were to treat Anthony Davis in this relationship the way he treated Kyrie Irving the first year they were together, I don't think it'd go over great. When he kept calling Kyrie a kid, and and it was, listen, I'm the vested champion. You've never had any success without me. But LeBron is much older than he was then, 5 years, and Anthony Davis is a much more established player with some playoff experience and a much older player than Kyrie was at the time.
Well, also, the second star has never been the one that's really gotten totally pushed to the sidelines. It's been the third star.
Yep.
Chris Bosh became the role player. Kevin Love became the role player. Kyrie was able to do his thing. Kyrie averaged more shots a game than LeBron, I think, their last year together. You know, Dwayne Wade, he did step back a little, but he still was a star with LeBron. So I think AD will get a chance to do his thing.
And one last point on the LeBron gets all the credit. That's the other thing that, by the way, is just not true. Like, you know, for 30% of sports media, who saved LeBron's legacy? Ray Allen. Remember? He's 2-7 without Ray Allen. Right. And in fact, you know what? He's actually 1-8 without Kyrie Irving. When you think, like, he's the only player ever that the expectation is, well, I mean, teammates made shots, so how good is he really? And so it is just the opposite of the way he's actually discussed. And the Griff being miserable, I bet he would want to clarify the exact meaning of that. Because I would imagine every day we have to be great. If anything short of a championship is a failure, that probably does weigh a hell of a lot heavier on you than right now his job with the Pelicans, where it's like, man, if we can get to 38 wins, we did a great thing this year.
But let me say this quickly, too. That's going to come with the territory. If he does a great job in New Orleans, and the article in Sports Illustrated was already saying he's done a great job, job. Maybe. We'll see.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a good GM, but let's see what these ex-Lakers do. Let's see what Zion becomes. Yeah. If Zion becomes what some people think he can, if the Lakers play well and Griff does a good job. I'm sorry, the Pelicans. If he does a good job, that pressure's coming. Because you get a little honeymoon period, but 4 years from now, they're going to be expected, if these guys play out and play well, to start winning championships or at least compete.
Daryl Morey's lifespan the last few years.
Now the pressure's on him.
The pressure's on.
All right, let's take a break. Coming up, back to some football. Baker and the Browns are taking aim at Big Ben and the Steelers. Talk about that next. No, first things first.